24-year-old Juan Catalan. Incredibly, he found himself under arrest for murdering a 16-year-old girl.
You killed somebody. Wait a minute. Those are very strong words right there. You guys are making the biggest mistake in the world.
Back in 2003, you know, I come on my way to work, dude, just a regular day. I got my girlfriend and we have our 5-year-old daughter in the back seat. And then out of nowhere, you know, these vehicles, they just cut us off. Like as we got into the parking lot, I was like, man, who the hell? Why are they parking like that? So I opened the door, dude. As soon as I opened the door, you know, they already, dude, right at me. I thought I was dead.
On May 12th, 2003, Martha Puebla sat outside her house on the street curb chatting with friends. As they spoke, a car drove slowly by her house, casing the area. The individual driving the car parked and got out of the vehicle. They walked up to Martha, pulled a gun out of her sweatshirt, and shot her in the head. Killing her instantly. The motive was later determined to be revenge. But who pulled the trigger? Martha Puebla had testified as a witness against defendant Jose Ledesma and co-defendant Mario Catalan at their preliminary hearing. They were members of a violent street gang called the Vineland Boys, and were being tried for the 2002 murder of Puebla's friend Christian Vargas. While she was on the stand, the judge asked her to point out the shooter in the courtroom. Puebla was unable to on the grounds that she didn't see the shooter well enough to be sure. Present at the preliminary hearing was Juan Catalan, Mario Catalan's brother.
Juan was in jail, charged with the May 12, 2003 murder of 16-year-old Martha Puebla. The young woman had testified in a separate case in which Juan's brother was a co-defendant.
Juan Catalan was arrested for the murder of Martha Puebla as he arrived to work.
I was like beyond scared, man, and I just kept asking, you know, what happened? And, oh, detectives want to talk to you.
Homicide detectives Martin Pinner and Juan Rodriguez questioned him about the murder.
You guys are gonna take away my life for this fucking bullshit?
What bullshit is this?
You killed somebody.
Wait a minute. Those are very strong words right there. I did not kill nobody. I would never kill nobody. And I never do anything to hurt anybody.
Convince us otherwise.
The detectives told Juan that the main witness to Puebla's murder sat down with a composite artist to create a sketch of the perpetrator. A sketch which resembled Juan. Detectives also told him that the witness had positively identified him as Puebla's killer. Detectives determined that Juan's motive for murdering Puebla was revenge for testifying against his brother, Mario Catalan.
Male Hispanic, black hair, very short, 5'7 to 5'11, 19 to 25 years old, stocky build, medium mustache, with
slight hair below his lip. I've never had nothing under my lip.
Well, what's under there right now?
Well, I haven't shaved.
Okay, so that you didn't shave this day either.
But why wouldn't I shave my mustache then?
I don't know, because you think you're cool. Because you think there were no witnesses. But there were witnesses.
Despite the evidence against him, Juan Catalan maintained his innocence all throughout questioning.
My attorney even said, he's like, hey man, he goes, you went, stood with them toe to toe, and that usually doesn't happen, man.
They're pros.
Yeah, they're pros. So they'll twist your words around. I'm like, oh, look, he's guilty.
Juan, facing the death penalty, hired Todd Melnick as his lawyer.
A cousin of mine. He used to be a filing clerk for his law firm. And dude, every time we would hang out, and he would always talk about them, dude. Like, oh man,
he's gonna be friends one day.
We're like, bro, nobody needs a lawyer. Bro, nobody, I'm serious. And when I got arrested, bro, that's the first thing that popped into my head. I kid you not, man.
During the first meeting, Melnick asked Catalan what he was doing on the night of the murder. Catalan told Melnick that he had been at Dodger Stadium for the Dodgers-Braves game on May 12, 2003.
You know, I told him everything, and dude, he never said a word. His eyes were like just getting bigger and bigger as he's hearing this story.
He attended the game with his 6-year-old daughter, his cousin Miguel, and his friend Ruben. As Catalan and his companions left the game, he stopped to buy some baseball cards for his daughter. Once outside the stadium, he placed a call to his girlfriend, drove his cousin Miguel home, and then went home himself. He didn't recall doing anything else that night.
Dude, I mean, he gave me a little bit of confidence because as soon as I was done speaking, you know, he's like, I'm going to get you out of here. I see no mas. And I was like, dude, you know, that helped a little bit.
Prosecuting attorney Beth Silverman was assigned to the case against Juan Catalan. She was nicknamed the sniper for a record of never having lost a death penalty case. Silverman was very adamant in her belief of Catalan's guilt, and she was willing to do everything in her power to make sure that her reputation and record wasn't broken.
She was murdered because she did testify. And the day that she testified, which was May 1st of 2003, Juan Catalan was present in the audience during his brother's preliminary hearing when this girl testified.
Belnick asked Catalan's girlfriend to find the Dodger tickets, and she did. But just because he had the baseball tickets doesn't mean he actually went to the game. Melnick needed further proof that Catalan was there. Melnick went to Dodger Stadium when it was empty and took reference photos of the seats that Catalan and his companions were sitting in. He then looked through hours of game footage in an attempt to identify any of the people seated around them. He was hoping that some of them could testify that they saw Catalan at the game that day, but they all stated that they didn't see Catalan well enough to be comfortable testifying. Melnick then painstakingly went through the footage from another set of cameras with the sole purpose of broadcasting video on the big screens at the stadium. He looked through the 27,000 plus fans that were at the game that day trying to find Catalan. And he did. But unfortunately, the resolution of the still frame was too low to be admissible in court.
You gonna promise to tell us the truth from what you remember?
Yeah.
Did you go to a Dodger game with your daddy this
yeah.
year, last year?
Yeah.
Did your daddy buy you anything during the game?
Yeah.
What did he buy you?
Ice cream and candy. And some Dodgers,
Juan Catalan's daughter testified in court that she went to the baseball game with her father and that he bought her ice cream, candy, and baseball cards. Prosecutor Beth Silverman doubted Catalan's alibi because he didn't bring it up when he was initially questioned by detectives.
Yeah, because I got arrested 3 months later. So these guys come in Yeah, so the night of the murder, which was May 12th, and then I come and get arrested August 12th.
Wow.
And then these guys are talking about, hey, where were you 3 months ago? I'm like, dude, I don't know where I was three days ago.
I don't remember.
Where was I 3 days ago? And I was like, man, I don't know.
Melnick spoke with Catalan again and asked him if he could think of anything that could place him at the game during the time of the murder. Catalan told Melnick that he thought he saw something being filmed at the game that day. He saw security blocking some of the aisles and a man walking up and down the stairs multiple times, as if it were for different takes of a scene. Melnick went back to Dodger Stadium and spoke with the media relations department. There had been a production company filming there that day. Melnick called the phone number and it turned out that it was HBO. The show that was being filmed at Dodger Stadium that day was none other than Curb Your Enthusiasm, created by and starring Larry David of Seinfeld fame.
When I go to the bathroom and I sit down on the toilet, my Johnson hangs in the water.
That's just such nonsense.
Still doesn't look familiar? Well, you probably have heard the Curb Your Enthusiasm theme song that has become a staple in meme culture. It is typically used when someone gets proved wrong or contradicts themselves.
It feels like neighborhood policing has vanished. It's not around you. We haven't seen a police while I've been here, and I've been here for a little while now. People are frightened, and worse than that, that's why young people don't come in.
Melnick explained the case and the situation to the show's producer, Tim Gibbons. Tim Gibbons then spoke with Larry David, who told them he didn't mind showing Melnick the footage. Gibbons called Melnick back and set up a time and day for him to come in. The episode that was being filmed on May 12th was called The Carpool Lane, in which Larry David is having trouble getting to Dodger Stadium for the game because of traffic. He ends up picking up a prostitute so he can use the carpool lane to get to the Dodger game faster.
Hey, Daddy, you want a date with Mama? Get in the car.
Melnick went to HBO Studios to view the footage. There were 8 tapes total with about 6 minutes of footage on each of them. If Melnick could find Catalan in this footage, it could quite literally save Juan Catalan's life. During the game, Juan Catalan's daughter had asked him for some candy, so they got up to go to the concession stand. When Catalan and his daughter returned from the concession stand, there was a camera crew blocking the aisle, and a PA was stopping people from getting in the way of the shot while they were filming. Catalan was originally stopped by this PA, but for whatever reason, the PA changed his mind and told Catalan he could go through, even though no one else was getting in. Catalan and his daughter were both captured on camera at Dodger Stadium on the night of the murder, proving Catalan's alibi to be true. Catalan could also be seen on two additional tapes. The first scene Catalan could be seen on was shot at 8:45 p.m., and the last scene he can be seen on was shot at 9:15 p.m. The only problem with this was that the murder took place at 10:32 p.m., creating a 1 hour and 17 minute window of time in which Catalan could have potentially committed the murder.
So the HBO tape, in your opinion, is good only for what?
Nothing.
The prosecutor didn't believe the Curb Your Enthusiasm footage proved anything. She stated that at 10:43, by Catalan's own admission, he was dropping off his cousin Miguel at home. Miguel lived on the same street 150 yards away from where the murder took place. So this didn't make things look good for Catalan. This also gave the prosecutor something solid to pursue when trying to prove Catalan's guilt at the preliminary hearing. While the Curb Your Enthusiasm footage did prove Catalan was at Dodger Stadium, Melnick still needed to place him at the game for a longer period of time. So he turned to phone records. Melnick contacted Nextel to find out what cell towers Catalan's phone was pinging off of at the time of the murder. This would definitively prove his location. The cell tower that Juan's phone used was across the street from Dodger Stadium and had a radius of 1 mile. This told Melnick that Catalan was at the stadium until at least 10:12 p.m., meaning that 1 hour and 17 minute window of time was now only 23 minutes. Making it far less plausible for Juan to have been able to commit the murder. But the prosecutor was convinced Catalan's secret identity was the Flash. So she still thought it was possible.
So I go into court, and then this, I would brief with my attorney in like a outer room, and then we would go into court and then get the court proceedings of that day. So dude, this one day he had this like look on his face, and I'm like, what's wrong, Todd? He's like, Juan, he goes, please, please, when you walk into the court, he goes, look straight ahead. Don't look into the audience because the girl's parents were there and family, bro.
Uh-huh.
Dude, I was like, damn. I go, okay, got it.
The preliminary hearing, where all of the evidence from both sides was reviewed and the judge would have the choice of sending the case to trial or dismissing it entirely on the grounds of insufficient evidence.
This man would be facing the death penalty if he hadn't, by the grace of God, gotten Dodger tickets from someone the day before and invited these people, got caught on video from that HBO show. You heard the tape of the interview with Detective Penner.
It is clearly a one-witness ID case. However, the one witness in this case is extremely credible, has no motive to lie, and made a composite drawing with a composite artist that is strikingly similar to the defendant's appearance.
After hearing all of the evidence, the judge now has the burden of deciding if she believes Juan Catalan is a murderer or a free man. At this moment, Juan Catalan's fate is entirely in her hands, and she decided to dismiss the case. But unfortunately, no, I'm just kidding. Nothing else happened. Juan Catalan is finally a free man.